Welcome, everyone, to the webinar on natural history. This webinar is in response to a request, and several requests, actually, that the organization has had over the last few weeks. Sadly, last Tuesday, we heard some very disappointing and distressing news about the Sarepta study, which was followed by some comments about the natural history and our interactions with the FDA. So we wanted you to know that none of the natural history you're going to hear is new. It is recent, and it's been presented in multiple times and at multiple forums. So with that, I'm going to turn the meeting over to Sharon Hesterly, who will facilitate with Dr. Craig McDonald the presentation on natural history. Sharon?
Okay, thank you all. I'm going to introduce Dr. Craig McDonald, who is an internationally recognized expert in the clinical management and rehabilitation of neuromuscular diseases, including muscular dystrophies, and in the development of novel outcome measures for clinical trials at UC Davis. Dr. McDonald is a recipient of over $16 million in federal grant support over the past 12 years and has been involved in a multitude of NIH, MDA, CDC, and Shriners Hospital national committees. He also serves as a consultant to the pharmaceutical industry regarding clinical trials in Duchenne muscular dystrophy and other dystrophies. Dr. McDonald is going to talk to you today about some, you know, and summarize some of the natural history data and studies that he's been involved in and some study data from others. All of these studies have been presented and some published and presented in multiple venues, and he's going to pull it together for you here now. At the end of the presentation, we will answer questions. We've received questions in advance from a multitude of people. So we'll save questions to the end of the presentation, and Dr. McDonald is going to leave some time at the end. But I will warn you, we may go a little bit over the hour just for planning purposes. So with that said, I'll turn it over to Dr. McDonald.
Great. Thanks, Pat and Sharon. It's really a privilege to be able to review much of this data that's been accumulated over a number of years. Just really as a matter of disclosure, I continue to serve as a consultant to multiple industry entities, including PTC Therapeutics, Eli Lilly, GSK, Sarepta, and Pfizer, where I've served as in the capacity of a consultant on clinical trials specifically involving boys and young men with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So, as again a matter of introduction, I've been involved in taking care of patients with Duchenne muscular dystrophy for over 25 years, and I've been involved in natural history studies for several decades. Back in 2007, I was approached by PTC Therapeutics with regard to development of optimal endpoints for a registration trial, specifically at that time for the drug Adalimumab. And we set out to actually develop and modify and ultimately validate the six-minute walk test for Duchenne muscular dystrophy. And we've really been quite pleased with what has transpired since that time in terms of the responsiveness of this endpoint and the ability of this endpoint to really show disease progression as well as clinically meaningful changes. As mentioned, there's really been a large amount of natural history data that we've collected in the Cooperative International Neuromuscular Disease Research Group, which is a collection of 22 centers, international centers that have been, we've been involved in a Duchenne natural history study for about 7 to 8 years collecting data. That work has been funded by Department of Education with NIDER, by NIH, and also by Department of Defense, as well as PPMD. And since we have been collecting natural history data, we also completed two manuscripts on the clinical meaningfulness, as well as longitudinal changes of the six-minute walk test over 48 weeks. And that data was much of those analyses were conducted over the past several years and have been presented in multiple forums. We actually prepared two manuscripts and submitted them to Muscle and Nerve in January. And those manuscripts were actually accepted by Muscle and Nerve, a peer-reviewed journal, with minor revisions in March of 2013. And really in an effort to move the field forward and maintain transparency I actually have shared these data with really a number of industry entities. And so just as a example, I actually sent these two manuscripts to Ed Kay and Sarepta, for instance, and I think they were very grateful for that and were able to actually review those manuscripts and actually were able to cite them in their Annals of Neurology publication, which Jerry Mendell was first author on. Before these manuscripts even became in press, and they were accepted in final form May 7th, and actually were available publicly as an e-publication in late June of 2013. And I was actually really privileged to be able to address the EMA as well as the academic community advocacy groups and a number of industry entities at a meeting that occurred in London in on June 21st, where the EMA had actually drafted a set of guidelines for Duchenne clinical trials. I think the clinical trials community had some concerns and some feedback for the EMA, and we were able to provide that to them in late June. And then really in a subsequent effort to really engage the FDA and get them interested in the possibility of drafting a set of guidelines of their own for Duchenne clinical trials, we actually met with the FDA in July. Most of that meeting actually involved presentation of risk-benefit data actually obtained from the Duchenne community. And I actually was able to spend 10 minutes with the FDA just really giving them some highlights of the natural history data that had been presented to the EMA and multiple industry entities at the June meeting in London. And I think, subsequent to that meeting, I think the FDA has, been interested in engaging in this process. And I'm happy to hear that PPMD, has been able to organize a meeting with the FDA to begin to discuss endpoints and natural history data and development possibly of a draft guideline for Duchenne clinical trials. Moving on here, so again, the next slide really just highlights that really much recent data has really been published in 2012 to 2013 concerning the natural history in Duchenne and the six-minute walk test. I think much of this data was actually published after the EMA had actually drafted their guideline. I should point out that there are a number of interventions that have really had a tremendous impact on the natural history of disease progression and survival in Duchenne. Glucocorticoids, the management of spine deformity, pulmonary management, and cardiac management specifically. And just to show the audience some examples of this, there's been really a changing natural history in Duchenne dystrophy really over the last four decades affecting survival. And so 1960 with no treatment, you can see the survival plots there on the left here. Really showing improvements in survival with each subsequent decade in Duchenne dystrophy. And then from the 1970s to 1990, we actually started seeing patients undergoing spine surgery and application of non-invasive ventilation, which both had a tremendous impact on the survival of patients with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. And then also ventilation specifically has really had a tremendous impact, the application of non-invasive ventilation in Duchenne. The ventilated median survival in this day and age is 27 years of survival without ventilation, 19 years. And a subsequent series, Pasamano in 2012, showed, again, a ventilated mean survival of 27.9 years and survival without ventilation of 17.7 years. So ventilation is at almost a 10-year, has really increased survival by 10 years in Duchenne dystrophy. And similarly, glucocorticoids and steroids have had an impact on survival, and the data from SRAM actually shows all all-cause mortality in Duchenne, and those treated with steroids have shown a much better survival as compared to those treated without steroids. And then obviously with ACE inhibitors and afterload reduction, such as medications like perindopril, which the data here on the right from Duboc actually shows the improved survival with afterload reduction of medications like lisinopril or enalapril or perindopril in Duchenne dystrophy. And so I think it's really, I think, important to show that, you know, what specifically in terms of clinical trials, what do we hope drugs will do in this more recent era of natural history with treatment, standard of care treatment with steroids. And obviously, first and foremost, we'd like to see data that would show that medications, novel medications, would slow down disease progression or even stop disease progression. And obviously, we would like to see these treatments improve or maintain functional abilities such as endurance or exercise tolerance or walking ability, arm function as measured by reach and grip and pinch and fine motor dexterity, self-care skills, as well as breathing function as well. So there are a variety of really clinically meaningful milestones that occur in a very predictable order in Duchenne dystrophy as far as the natural history. And so as far as ambulatory milestones, inability to jump, hop, or run, the Gower sign with standing, loss of standing from the floor, loss of the ability to transition from lying to sitting, loss of stair climbing, loss of the ability to stand from a chair, loss of ability to walk independently, or loss of inability to stand in place. These would all be really meaningful ambulatory milestones that we would hope that treatments would have an impact on. But there are a variety of non-ambulatory milestones as well, such as loss of ability to reach overhead, reach the scalp, the measurement of 50% vital capacity, which by the care guidelines indicate need for cough assistance, loss of ability to feed oneself, loss of ability to place the hands to a tabletop, and inability to sustain adequate ventilation overnight, which would be an indicator of need for ventilation with BiPAP or non-invasive ventilation, or loss of ability to use a computer. And as we look at this changing natural history in Duchenne dystrophy, with contemporary management with steroids and improved cardiac management, really, steroids have affected disease progression in Duchenne dystrophy really over the entire course of the disease, prolonging these clinically meaningful functions or time to loss of these important milestones such as standing, walking, self-feeding, ventilation as well. So just as an example of this with steroids, the gray bars here actually show the percentages of patients that at different age groups who are actually able to continue to do these important functions, standing from the floor, climbing stairs, rising from a chair. And the gray bars are the steroid-treated patients. The black bars are the patients that are steroid-naive. And you can see that with steroids, many more patients are able to do these important functions for a longer period of time. And this was data that we published with Eric Hendricks, that is first author, in 2013 with our Synergy database. And similarly, steroids have prolonged the loss of ambulation. Patients have been able to maintain the ability to walk for much longer on steroids, as shown in this data here. And this is the survival curve, really showing that steroids can prolong ambulation by periods of up to 3 years, which really shows a significant impact on disease progression. And then more recent data that we've presented and published actually shows that even adults with Duchenne dystrophy, a much higher percentage who have been treated long-term with steroids have maintained the ability to actually get the hand to the mouth and feed themselves independently. So steroids are really having an impact over the entire course of disease. And in terms of conducting clinical trials, I think a key natural history concept is that earlier functional abilities really predict later functional abilities, and the timing of the loss of these clinically meaningful functions or milestones really predict when later milestones will be lost. So just as an example, if we if we look at the natural history time to stand, so if you measure actual time to stand, that actually is predictive of loss of standing ability. Loss of standing actually is predictive of loss of ambulation or age at loss of ambulation. If you look at age at loss of ambulation, that actually is predictive of age at loss of self-feeding, and even age at loss of ambulation is also predictive of age at the onset of need for non-invasive ventilation. And so here, for example, here's data that actually shows this very strong linear relationship between loss of standing ability and age at loss of ambulation. And this has been shown in several trials in the synergy data here. The correlation was on the order of 0.90. The French actually, Humbert Claude actually showed a correlation of 0.91 for this relationship. And then again, here's our synergy natural history data. This is the survival curve of loss of ambulation for those who are unable to stand. And you can see that if a young man with Duchenne loses the ability to stand, 43.3% actually lose ambulation over the next 12 months. And again, this is synergy data. In the PTC trial, if patients at the onset of that trial were unable to stand at baseline, actually 46.7% actually lost ambulation over the next 48 weeks if they were unable to stand at baseline. In comparison, those that are able to stand at baseline, only one of 144 in the PTC trial, or less than 1%, lost ambulation over the next 48 weeks. So here's actually two completely different data sets. The synergy data set, which includes patients with all mutation types, and then the PTC data set, which actually includes patients who completely lack dystrophin, but due to a nonsense mutation or stop codon mutation, really showing very similar proportions of patients losing ambulation if the ability to stand is lost, 43.3% versus 46.7%. And similarly, age at loss of ambulation predicts age at loss of ability to raise the hand to the mouth and feed oneself, and this relationship has been shown in our synergy data and has been confirmed in a French data set. And then finally, the age at loss of ambulation predicts time to percent vital capacity of 30%, or the need for non-invasive ventilation is indicated by the care standards. And so if you look at patients with Duchenne who lose ambulation before the age of 8 versus after the age of 11, there's this very significant difference in terms of the proportions of patients that actually transition to needing non-invasive ventilation. And you can see 8 versus 11, that's 3 years, and that's really, an effect that steroids may have over time. We've also learned that even different steroid regimens can actually have a tremendous impact on these milestones. And this is data that we've recently presented at a national forum that's in preparation right now by Dr. Luca Bella of the Synergy Network has pulled these data together based on our natural history study in Duchenne dystrophy. And this really shows the age at loss of ambulation in a population of Duchenne patients treated with deflazacort versus those treated with prednisone. And you can see here's the mean age of 13.22 in those treated with deflazacort versus 11.2 treated with prednisone. And you can see the difference in survival curves of loss of ambulation, the red being those treated with deflazacort, the blue being those treated with prednisone or prednisolone. And so obviously as we look at natural history studies and we're seeing patients that are actually in Europe and some patients in the United States being treated with effective medications like deflazacort, we're seeing that really trying to demonstrate a additional incremental benefit by medications such as those that increase dystrophin production or those anabolic agents is somewhat of a challenge that we need to consider in the context of clinical trial development. In addition, there are changes that we see in a typical 1 year period of time. So when we ask ourselves the question, what can we use to measure effect of a drug on disease progression in a one-year trial. There are these typical one-year changes for boys with Duchenne who are ambulatory, who are deteriorating. So, for instance, strength of the knee extensors, there may be just a two-pound loss in knee extension over a year. Time to climb four stairs, 3 to 4 second increase. North Star, a 7-point decrease. And again, the North Star data coming out of the GSK trial, we learned that the placebo-treated patients actually had a 7-point decrease in the North Star, but the clinically meaningful change of the North Star is actually 10 points. And so a clinical trial using the North Star as an endpoint would actually have to show an improvement in the North Star, not just stability in the North Star, and able to show a clinically meaningful change in a 48-week trial. And so, for example, on a 6-minute walk test, there's in some natural history data, on average, a 44-meter decline over a year. So if a clinically meaningful change is 30 meters over the course of the year, if we could at least slow the progression of the disease or stabilize the disease, we might be able to measure that with something like the 6-minute walk test. Forced vital capacity in a non-ambulant population may show a 5% decrease. But again, if we're looking at younger boys with Duchenne dystrophy, we may actually see stability in forced vital capacity or even increase in the absolute value of forced vital capacity. So again, we have to choose our endpoints based on the stage of the disease that we're actually evaluating. So for instance, if we take the 6-minute walk test over 48 weeks, if we expect a change of 44 meters and a clinically meaningful drug effect would be 30 meters, if we could slow the course of the disease and really demonstrate a 30-meter effect of a drug, that would be clinically meaningful and something that we could statistically show in the course of a clinical trial. So there's been really evolution of endpoints, and I just list four recent multi-center clinical trials. The 2008 Adalurin trial, which primary endpoint was 6-minute walk test. There were a variety of exploratory and secondary endpoints, but really the endpoints in that trial, as well as other trials, the GSK trial, the recent Lilly trial, which is underway, and the newer multi-center Adalurin trial, I think the 6-minute walk test and the time function test have been endpoints that have actually been consistently applied now. There have been a number of other exploratory endpoints that have actually been discontinued over the course of a clinical trial. And so North Stars actually was not available for the Adalurin trial, but has been added to a variety of clinical trials. And previously, the PEDS-QL was used, but we've learned that it's a relatively insensitive measure in Duchenne, whereas the PODC is a much better measure in Duchenne. We mentioned, again, the North Star. Again, this is a 17-point functional scale. And we know, we've learned that a 10-point change on the linearized North Star is something that is really clinically meaningful. Going from 90 to 80 it means no longer able to hop. A change from 21 to 11 is loss of ability to stand. And so a 10-point change has been determined to be clinically meaningful, and we've actually been able to use the North Star to measure effects of steroids on both a daily regimen versus an intermittent regimen. But one key point here is the North Star change in the placebo group over 48 weeks in the GSK trial was only 6.7 points. So, again, the challenge of demonstrating a clinically meaningful change of 10 points in the course of clinical trial when the placebo group only changes 6.7 points over time. So, again, despite that, I think the North Star has been used and included now as a secondary endpoint in a variety of trials which are underway in Duchenne dystrophy, so we've made some progress there. With regard to the 6-minute walk test, I'm going to spend the rest of the time really focusing on this endpoint because it's been the endpoint which, again, has been validated probably is the most responsive to treatment effects on top of steroids in Duchenne muscular dystrophy. And just to summarize the amount of work that has been actually done validating this measure in Duchenne, the 6-minute walk test actually correlates with stride length or cadence or steps taken per minute, which actually is a measure of disease progression using gait laboratory techniques. It correlates with knee extension strength, It correlates with biomechanical efficiency of walking. It correlates with endurance measures as measured by accelerometers placed on the body. And it also correlates with gross motor measures such as the North Star. So that six-minute walk test is really a whole body, global integrated measure of systems involved in walking. And this has been well validated now in Duchenne muscular dystrophy. But with regard to the six-minute walk test, we have natural history data on the measure since 2007. It's the most reliable endpoint. It's the most, it's really well validated in Duchenne. And it's consistently been the most sensitive and responsive endpoint in clinical trials of ambulatory Duchenne patients that include steroid-treated patients. And really, we have the best data regarding clinical meaningfulness of this endpoint in a Duchenne population. So first of all, I'd like to address the issue of, is there a difference in the six-minute walk changes over time based on different mutations with Duchenne muscular dystrophy? And this is actually data that is impressed by Payne and colleagues, including Eugenio McCurry, who really led this effort. And this shows baseline values of six-minute walk test by age, and this would be patients with an exon 44 skippable mutation, patients here are patients with exon 51 skippable mutations. The gray background there shows the entire cohort. The black dots are those patients with that specific mutation. And these would be patients here with an exon 53 skippable mutation. So you can see that there's really a nice overlap quite a bit of variability, but nice overlap in the specific mutation groups. So the mutation groups are not really behaving substantially differently. And so if we look, for instance, at patient populations that are exon 51 skippable, this would be the mean value. There's slight changes with patients. Generally, exon 44 skippable patients have a slight change in terms of baseline six-minute walk values. But really what's most important is what are the changes over time. And this is actually the change scores in six-minute walk test, showing this really nice overlap of really all the mutations, quite a bit of variability within each mutation. But again, if we look at the change scores in the six-minute walk distance over time, we can see that they're all very similar, other than exon 44 specific patients that seem to have a little bit of a slower progression compared to some of the other groups, point mutations showing a slightly less rapid progression, and exon 53 patients showing a slightly more progression. But on statistical analyses, there was really a nice overlap, and the conclusions of this study was that really patients eligible for skipping of exon 44 had better baseline values and less drastic changes than those eligible for skipping of exons 44, 40, 45, or 43, but the difference was not statistically significant. And so really the conclusion is that even if there's some slight differences among subgroups, the mean 12-month changes in each subgroup were really all within a very narrow range from the mean of the entire Duchenne cohort, really measured statistically. And then we then turn to the issue of the natural history data. Probably the most complete natural history data set is based on initially published was that of the Adalurin placebo-controlled data. We learned from our observational trial, this was patients with a variety of mutations in Duchenne, that there was these maturational issues, but there were also variability issues in disease progression, with some patients progressing more slowly and some patients progressing more rapidly. And these variability issues are explained by steroids, by genetics, polymorphisms or slight genetic changes apart from the Duchenne gene, and then also baseline levels of function as well. And so if you look at the data here from the Adalurin trial, it actually lined up, and we found similar maturational and variability issues. This is data presented out of Belgium from Natalie Gomans in patients with a variety of mutations with Duchenne dystrophy, again showing this maturational issue before the age of 7, and then variability issues in disease progression, depending again on a variety of factors, including baseline levels of function. And when we actually went, when we actually compare the natural history data from the placebo arm of the Adalurin trial, these would be all nonsense mutations. With the natural history data out of Belgium of patients with really a variety of mutations, these data are almost superimposable in terms of how similarly they're behaving. And in fact, the nonsense mutation patients average a change of 44 meters over the course of a year, whereas the patients in the Goman's natural history study with a variety of mutations changed 43 meters, again, with almost identical standard deviations. The baseline six-minute walk distance was slightly higher in the Adalurin-treated patients, 361 meters, whereas the baseline value here in the Belgian patients was 348 meters. And again, in the Adalurin trial, there were possibly one or two patients in each cohort that may have had Becker dystrophy, but for the most part, the investigators really tried to include patients who had Duchenne muscular dystrophy, and it's really felt to be really a Duchenne cohort as opposed to a Becker cohort. And then again, when we look at this 52-week or one-year change data out of Belgium from Natalie Gomans, 25 patients actually had follow-up results, so not as many patients as Adalurin. But again, a 43-meter change, which was very almost identical to that seen in the Adalurin natural history trial. Because of these maturational issues, we actually have come up with a percent predicted value of six-minute walk distance, which actually accounts for height and age-related changes, and so that can also be applied to the data as well. Now, we can look to other clinical trials for natural history data, and so, for instance, if we look, for instance, to the GSK 117 trial, this was the study conducted in a younger cohort comparing continuous with intermittent dosing with the GSK drug. And if you look at that drug, I think one important point to make here is that really this was an earlier disease population. They had to rise from the floor in less than 7 seconds. They tended to be younger. They tended to be around 7 years of age. And again, the comparison was the continuous versus the intermittent dosing. But if we look here at the baseline values of the patients in this trial, they were a little bit less affected than that data that I've published and Natalie Gomans has published. They were had six-minute walk distances on the order of 400 to 425 meters. And there was a treatment effect here on the order of 35 meters, which was statistically significant at 25 weeks in that trial. And that treatment effect seemed to hold up over the course of the 48 weeks in that trial with results that were almost statistically significant. But again, I should point out, really, that population was younger, better functioning. This is actually data that GSK has made public, really showing the patients in the trial, the GSK trial, who were at all ages, the baseline value in the placebo treated patients was 348 meters. The baseline value in the drosaprazine-treated patients was 337 meters. So a treatment effect of only 10 meters, which we were all disappointed about. But again, it's only 48-week data. That was what the study duration was. If you look at the younger than 7-year-old patients, they change about 25 meters. The patients who were over the age of 7 change about 82 meters. And so, again, I think this is very useful natural history data, but we should point out that if you do the cut points at, say, a baseline value of 330 meters on the six-minute walk test and either above 330 meters or below 330 meters, you actually see values that are actually line up fairly closely to that seen with the age cut point of 25 meters and 82 meters, and I'm sure we'll see data to that effect over the coming weeks. But we should point out, if you look at the entire cohort, again, the baseline value on the six-minute walk test is 348 meters of the entire cohort, 52-meter change over a year's time. Those that are younger patients, younger than age 7, had a baseline value of 382 meters, and changed 25 meters. Those who were older, at least in the GSK trial, had a baseline value of 316 meters. So again, many of those patients who were younger and better functioning were actually enrolled in the 117 trial earlier, and so I think there was a selection bias in this study, which accounted for a slightly more severe initial disease severity. So the drisapersen-treated patients actually here, the baseline value was 337 meters, which is almost 20 meters lower than that seen in other cohorts and 10 meters lower than seen in the Gomans cohort. So I think this is the data really that I think when we start to look at this issue of maturational improvements, relative stability that occurs over time, and then patients who are actually in a decline phase, much of that is really important to really look at the issue of baseline 6-minute walk distance. And in our original data, natural history data, there was a reason why we sort of drew a line at age 7 and drew a line around 350 meters was because the patients behaved slightly differently, younger than 7 and older than 7 and above 350 meters and below 350 meters. So, for instance, if you look at those patients who are younger or those patients who have a baseline value of 350 meters, their change is really really quite minimal over time if we just look at 350 meters, but we include the entire age cohort there. But if we actually do a further break point by looking at the patients that were actually above 350 meters and above 7 years of age, we get a slight increase. They do decline. They decline on the order of 18 meters over 48-week period of time. And if we then look at the patients who are actually below 350 meters, we see these much more substantial declines that occur over time as patients entering this decline phase. So again, to summarize, looking at the Adalurin data where we have the stability over 350 meters, more decline in patients less than 350 meters, if you really combine these two groups together, you essentially get the data that I published showing a 44-meter decline and the data published by Goman showing a 43-meter decline. This is really not the only data sets to show these kinds of changes. And these are data that Eugenio Mercuri provided to me recently. Again, really showing this data broken out by younger than 7 years of age, above 350, below 350. And those younger patients who are better functioning tend to actually increase their 6-minute walk distance, hence the need for the percent predicted value. But if you again take Mercuri's data, and these are all mutations, and do that breakpoint of greater than 7 years and a 350 decline, they found a 13-meter decline, and those that were greater than 7 years of age and less than 350 showed a 70-meter decline. And in a slightly different data set, Mercuri finds about a 30-meter decline in those patients that were above 350 and about a 64-meter decline in those patients that were those patients that were below 350. So, again, I think when designing a trial, we have to really look at the baseline levels of severity. If the 6-minute walk distance is greater than 350 or a value of 55 to 60% predicted, the trial really needs to show improved 6-minute walk distance or percent predicted values or use an increased study duration of longer to demonstrate efficacy. And again, if the patients are more severely affected, the question is the dystrophin expression going to be sufficient in the lower extremities to stabilize ambulation over 48 weeks, or would a 2-year trial or a longer trial be necessary in the patients who are actually declining? So I think this is where I think the natural history data that's emerging is becoming really very useful. And when we look here at 2-year natural history data, I think this really sheds light on the impact of some of these treatments and drugs. So, for instance, in Natalie Goman's 2-year data, Their two-year data actually, using a variety of mutation types, actually shows about 125-meter decline in the 14 patients that they studied over 2 years, with a baseline six-minute walk distance value of about 339 meters in that smaller cohort. So the patients were a bit more severe at onset, at least in that cohort. And again, if we look at Eugenia McCurry, their two-year data, they actually, again, show in patients that are above the age of 7 and greater than 350 meters, or the patients that are above the age of 7 or less than 350 meters, about a 78-meter decline if you exclude the patients who actually lost ambulation, or a 104-meter decline if they were below 350 meters. If you actually impute zero values and add in those 18 patients that lost ambulation, we get a much more dramatic change in the six-minute walk distance over time of 97 meters or 185 meters. But this includes the patients who actually lost the ambulation and imputes a zero value for those six-minute walk distance. This actually excludes the patients who lost the ambulation, and you see a 78-meter change in those patients that were older than age 7 and above 350. So I think that's really useful data as we begin to look at these measures in terms of responsiveness of these therapies to the six-minute walk data. So just moving ahead then to the responsiveness that we've seen in a variety of clinical trials, the Adalurin trial actually did show a treatment effect. It just missed statistical significance, but it was a treatment effect of, on the order of 30 meters over time. With the appropriate dose of Adalurin. And again, we can look at the proportions of patients who actually lose 10% of their six-minute walk distance, and about a quarter of the patients on Adalurin progressed versus almost half of the patients who are not on Adalurin actually progressed on that form of analysis. But if we actually take a subpopulation that was actually in more of a decline phase of ambulation, the treatment effect actually becomes much greater, showing a treatment effect of almost 50 meters, 49.9 meters over the course of that trial, and highly statistically significant at 0.096. That treatment effect in the Adalurin trial was actually seen over a variety of disease severities, and so even in the milder patients that were greater than 70% predicted six-minute walk distance values, they actually improved their six-minute walk distance versus placebo at the 20-meter improvement. And those that were 50 to 70% predicted showed a 47-meter improvement, and those that were less than 50% showed a 41-meter improvement. But we were able, again, with the six-minute walk test, to show treatment effect over really a variety of disease severities. Now, again, just to remind you, when the GSK studies have actually included a variety of open-label and placebo-controlled trials, and really starting initially with their initial repeat dose escalation study where they have a long extension phase, 177 weeks of extension data that's been completed. And GSK has made public their 177-week efficacy data, 3.4 years of follow-up. The original study was actually published in New England Journal showing the effect of the Prosenza GSK exon skipping 51 drug in a Duchenne population. So if we look at longer term extension data, and this is data out to 3.4 years now, you can see that looking at the percent changes in 6 minute walk distance, there were two patients that went off their feet. But the other patients have actually maintained stability over 3.4 years after starting on that drug on the GSK Prosenza exon 51 skipping drug. And in fact, when we look at the changes based on baseline 6 minute walk distances, you can see that it was really the patients that had higher 6 minute walk distance values who did seem to respond better to the drug, There's a lot of patients who are showing stability out to 3.4 years. Those patients who actually started, who were more severe, actually lost ambulation. But the median change in six-minute walk distance in this GSK-treated population was actually an increase in six-minute walk distance of 7.5 meters over the course of 3.4 years. In contrast that to the two-year natural history data really published by Domans and calculated by McCurry, which shows a two-year change in six-minute walk distance on the order of 78 meters to 125 meters over time. Really, I think, pretty impressive data when you look at the two-year results. And again, I think if you break that data out by this was the one they actually started back on the GSK drug. There was a period of time they were off drug. But when they started back on drug, those patients who had higher percent predicted values actually were those that stabilized, and those with lower percent predicted values were those that actually tended to decline on the drug. And I think these two-year data are really, I think, important to look at in interpreting the eteplirsen data, which I think are very impressive, 96-week follow-up data over time that show that the eteplirsen, the six patients that were treated with the eteplirsen drug, two on the lower dose and two on the higher dose, actually had a 18-meter decline when taking the maximum capacity or maximum ability on the six-minute walk test. These are the patients who actually were started at 24 weeks in time. These are the patients on the delayed placebo extension. But if you at least look at natural history data that has been determined on the six-minute walk test, if the natural history is on the order of 78 meters to 125 meters over 2 years, I think that actually shows really some encouraging treatment effect at the two-year follow-up data with the eteplirsen drug. So then, just to conclude, in terms of clinical meaningfulness of the six-minute walk distance, we can look at a variety, its prediction on a variety of methodologies and milestones, but generally higher baseline function or stabilization of baseline function, even over the short term by 30 meters, is associated with less progression to 10% over a year, and it's almost always associated with slower long-term decline in Duchenne dystrophy. And so then, again, if we look at those that lose 10% ambulation over the course of a year, the red shows patients who lose 10%. The blue shows patients who don't lose 10%. And you can see that the 10% decline in ambulation is really associated with a much greater percentage of patients losing ambulation over the next 4 years. Again, looking at it a different way, this is data looking at the initial six-minute walk distance survival curve. When you decline by 30 meters, that puts you into this group of patients who actually are showing much more greater propensity to progress with that lower baseline value on the six-minute walk test. Six-minute walk test has actually been shown to actually predict not only years to ambulation, but weeks to ambulation in a linear fashion over time. So when you drop below a critical threshold from a mean value closer to 350 down to 325 meters, there then becomes a higher predilection to losing ambulation over time. So really to summarize, if you lose 30 meters from baseline, that's associated with 10% worsening over a year. 10% worsening over a year is associated with loss of ambulation over 4 years. And then as Eugenio McCurry has actually taken the baseline values of six-minute walk distance and separated them out by 30-meter increments, we can see that 30 meters is important in terms of prediction of loss of ambulation over the next 2 years. So those patients with lower six-minute walk distance values have a much higher risk of losing ambulation than those patients with higher values. And with each 30-meter decrement, there's a higher rate of loss of ambulation, really showing the clinical meaningfulness of a 30-meter increment in the six-minute walk distance as a measure of disease progression. And then finally, with the six-minute walk test, it does correlate to patient-reported outcome measures and this is data from the PODSI measure, correlating six-minute walk distance with the global score of the PODSI. And so we now have confirmatory evidence based on patient-reported outcome measures that the six-minute walk distance is clinically meaningful. So, again, to conclude, we have much new data over the past couple of years. 30 meters is a minimally clinically important difference. The six-minute walk distance measures disease progression. It predicts loss of ambulation. The North Star is a new emerging measure, but, again, natural history changes of 7 points over time, with 10 points being clinically meaningful, really demonstrates perhaps some limited sensitivity of the North Star over time. So I think the investigators in the Duchenne community now really have identified a variety of potential endpoints, measures of decline of ambulation. We're looking at functional decline of upper limb functions, pulmonary function parameters, and cardiac endpoints. And there's really a lot of natural history data that's emerging on these variety of endpoints that are applicable throughout the stages of disease in Duchenne dystrophy, and a variety of promising exploratory endpoints as well. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and stop and entertain a few questions.
Okay. Thank you, Craig. And as we start with questions, I just want to reiterate, we received a lot of questions in advance. There were written questions. We went over these with Dr. McDonald, and some of them we felt were pretty sure would be answered in his presentation. There were some others that were very specific to regulatory issues and not as relevant to natural history, so we may not get to all of them. If you feel that your question has not been answered and you really want to answer, email me afterwards and we'll see what we can do. And we will also try to get to some of the ones that have appeared in the box that have come up as Dr. McDonald's presentation has been ongoing. But just to start with, just in general, with the results of the Tuflison phase two study or the decision from the FDA, I guess a lot of focus has been on 6 minute time walk. So we've just heard an awful lot about this endpoint. Can you put it in context for people so that we can understand why it's so important for this decision?
Well, I think fairly consistently in a variety of trials, at least in ambulatory Duchenne trials, the 6 minute walk distance has emerged as the key primary endpoint used in trials. The secondary endpoints, usually we like to see them moving in the same direction. We do have quite a bit of natural history data, and the six-minute walk test really is shown to be the most sensitive measure. It's really the best measure we have at this point in time. So while there are other endpoints that potentially could emerge or composite endpoints, we don't have the natural history data on those measures right now to allow us to really design clinical trials moving forward.
So then let me follow up with one of the questions that came in during your presentation, and that is, as people try to digest all of this information you presented, and I think a lot of people on the phone are thinking, so how does this apply to, the Tuflison study? One of the questions that came in is, how long would a group of about 10 boys need to remain stable before you could say there was a treatment effect?
Well, again, I think it a lot of that really depends on the baseline characteristics of the 10 boys. And so I think, what would be helpful would actually be, to present data on the specific baseline six-minute walk distances and characteristics of the 10 boys. I think that, obviously, I think that part of that is going to be based on their baseline characteristics. I think depending on what their characteristics were, if they were stable, you could demonstrate that in a 48-week trial. In other instances, depending on what their baseline characteristics was, it might require a two-year follow-up to really demonstrate convincing degrees of stability. So I think it really depends on the baseline characteristics, age, baseline 6 minute walk distance, and as well as, but I think the data that has been presented by Strapped on the eteplirsen drug, as I alluded to, the 2-year data is really, very impressive, as was, I think, the 3.4-year data that was presented with the GSK drug.
Okay, and someone else has asked about how well statistically powered some of the data that you presented, and so, you've obviously presented data from multiple data sets, but I think you've indicated, that what was statistically significant throughout.
Well, I think there's been statistical calculations and p-values presented. I think if you look at the size of the cohorts that have been published by myself with the nonsense mutation Adalimumab placebo group, by Natalie Gomans with her natural history study on a variety of mutations, as well as the data that's been accumulated by Eugenia McCurie. I mean, those data sets are on the order of 50-plus patients on up to 190 patients that have been included in the McCurie data set looking at effective mutation. So these are fairly, they're not data sets that are in the thousands that we would like to eventually see, but they're certainly data sets that are in the order of 50 plus patients, 290 patients, mm-hmm. And so obviously has some degree of statistical robustness.
And independent data sets that seem to be consistent in their conclusions.
Right. I think independent data sets and also data sets that do involve a variety of mutations with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. And there may be slight subtle changes in natural history by mutation subtype or by those have not generally I think the data has run really quite consistent from data set to data set.
Mm-hmm. Someone else has asked an important question about the data from the placebo groups, and if that data, if it could be combined, would help strengthen the natural history data we've gathered so far.
I think absolutely. I think not only placebo control groups, but also I think the true natural history data that's being collected around the world, I think could be combined. I mean, one thing we have identified is that the placebo control groups seem to be behaving in a manner consistent with the published natural history of the disease. And so the hope would be that, my guess is that the industry entities will actually be willing to share data to allow investigators to combine data sets. And so I think with combination of multiple data sets, I think we'll have much more powerful natural history data that we can evaluate drugs against.
Can you briefly mention, what would be the challenges to doing that? Are there barriers that we should address to be able to combine those data sets?
Well, I think that the academic community, such as the Synergy Network and the groups from Belgium and Italy, have really been quite willing to combine data sets. I think that PTC Therapeutics has actually, they had the first data set really available that became available back in 2009 to 2010. And, I think PTC has been very transparent in sort of providing these data to the Duchenne community. And I would hope that that other companies that have, very useful placebo-controlled data, will make these data available. And by all indications that I get from talking to leadership from GSK, I think they are going to, be willing to make these placebo-controlled data available to allow these sorts of analyses.
So, talking about the timing of studies, it sounded a little bit, based on the FDA response on the eteplirsen decision, like they weren't keen to use 6-minute time walk as an outcome for a small, 48-week trial. Do you see some way that, I mean, how long of a trial do you think would be necessary?
Well, I think the first point is that, you know, I haven't ever gotten a sense that that either the EMA or the FDA, you know, would not be, you know, willing to entertain 6-minute walk distance as an endpoint. I think that they remain flexible. I think they'd like to see other endpoints refined and developed that could be perhaps applied in a broader population of Duchenne patients. I think that as we get better natural history data on endpoints such as the 6-minute walk test and other endpoints, I think there remains a real possibility that we may be able to do the advantage of doing or the disadvantage of not having a placebo arm and with a natural history comparison could essentially be utilized in a longer term trial. So if we increase the study durations, that might allow us to actually get by without relying on placebo comparison treatment arms. So I think there may be obviously some disadvantage in terms of timing and doing a longer-term trial, say 2 years in duration, but there may be added benefits in terms of the natural history data may be so compelling in a two-year trial to allow us to actually get by with, without a placebo arm. But I think that's really a decision that, is ultimately going to be made by the FDA. But I think it's imperative that the academic community and industry tries to really bring the data together and make a cogent argument to the FDA to allow these various study designs.
Okay, so another specific question that has come in is, you said on the Larynx Swan call that you believe eteplirsen works, yet the FDA cites data you provided as a reason why to believe it does not. What would you say to the FDA to substantiate your claim that you're confident eteplirsen works?
Well, I think I've really told a variety of people and entities that I think eteplirsen is showing activity and that eteplirsen works. I think the most compelling data that I see is the 2-year extension data that's showing relative stability of the treated patients at 2 years. I think that's very compelling versus the natural history data, which shows that really in that age cohort, regardless of initial 6-minute walk distance, there would typically be a greater propensity to see decline over time. So I think really the 2-year data is really in my mind pretty compelling. I also think the 3.4 year data on the GSK drug is showing that the drug seems to be working in selected patients. But obviously the GSK trial was a 48 week trial. And so they were, and they didn't demonstrate efficacy in the context of a 48-week trial performed over a variety of patients with different disease severity.
Right, and just to clarify, people, that, there's a trial that can be designated as a registration study, and so the 48-week trial for GSK was their registration study, and it was powered for that, whereas the 3.4-year trial had much lower numbers of participants.
Right, so it was, there wasn't necessarily a placebo arm in the longer-term trial. The open label extension trial wasn't really powered to be a registration trial or a phase 3 trial, whereas their pivotal trial actually was powered, but it was powered on the basis of really 48 weeks, and that's what this statistical analysis was based on. And I'm sure be hearing as the subgroup analyses are performed over the coming weeks, and perhaps some of this data emerges from the longer-term extension phase patients who are in that pivotal trial, whether we may be seeing some treatment effect with longer drug exposures over time with patients followed out to 2 years. That will be very interesting to see. But I think certainly getting back to the eteplirsen data, I think it's really very very compelling, the 2-year stability in those 6 treated patients. That being said, there were the patients with more severe disease severity early on that didn't respond to the drug in terms of a 6-minute walk test, but perhaps they may show evidence of responding to the drug with other endpoints.
Mm-hmm. It actually kind of begs an interesting question about the Drosafferson study, since that was it wasn't stopped. They just held dosing. So technically, that's still an open protocol. In theory, anyway, I know that GSK is continuing to do their analysis, but the result of that analysis might be that the trial should have been longer.
That could be a conclusion. And if that is a conclusion, then I think a decision will have to be made as to whether patients could conceivably be put back on drug. But I think we'll hear about those data, I think, in the coming weeks. Both their subgroup analyses as well as their analyses on the extension phase.
Okay, so a kind of different question that has come up. Several people have asked about enrollment criteria, and I think they're thinking about the phase 3 follow-on for eteplirsen, but they're asking how difficult it was to enroll for the Drosafferson study since the U.S. phase wasn't fully enrolled. I wondered if you had any comment on that.
It was the U.S. study was specifically designed to evaluate the differences of a 3-milligram dose with a 6-milligram dose. In that particular trial, that's what it was powered to demonstrate, not based on efficacy. But I think that the criteria in that trial actually were fairly stringent in terms of patients had to rise from the floor in less than 7 seconds, which actually I think there were a number of patients that we could have enrolled that did not meet that entry criteria. Now, that was liberalized towards the end of the trial, but I think there was only one patient that was enrolled in that trial that actually could not rise from the floor, that actually rose from the floor in greater than 7 seconds. So that liberalization was made fairly late in the trial. The trial was they made the decision to go ahead and complete the study after I think 51 patients were enrolled. Their original target was 54 patients. But these when you get into these criteria of 6-minute walk characteristics, standing times, and so forth, it does create challenges. In addition, we had U.S. patients who actually had traveled to Canada to enroll in the pivotal trial. The 044 trial, and so that also, I think, impacted, some of the enrollment for the U.S. trial as well, because some of the U.S. patients actually had traveled to enroll in the pivotal trial.
Okay, and then there were a couple of questions about surrogate markers and biomarkers. One of them was, is the FDA considering any other biomarkers for Duchenne?
Well, I think the FDA always is willing to consider biomarkers. There's a huge effort in the academic community right now to develop serum biomarkers in Duchenne dystrophy. It's really critical for the academicians to actually demonstrate the usefulness, responsiveness of these biomarkers to treatment effects, and also the natural history of these biomarkers. I don't think there's any that are really ready to go prime time in terms of being. I think there are exploratory biomarkers that are constantly being included in clinical trials. And then with regard to dystrophin quantification, there's great efforts being made, I think, in the international academic community to further refine and try to improve upon that methodology, and I'm sure we'll hear more about that in the upcoming meeting with the FDA in terms of the FDA draft guidance for clinical trial their clinical trial draft guidance meeting coming up in December, sponsored by PPMD.
Okay, and then I'm going to finish with just a couple of questions that came in during your presentation about your early data showing that one loss of one ability can predict the loss of another ability. And you sort of showed that you could sort of extrapolate all the way from time it takes to get off the floor to survival if you move up, you know, each loss predicts the next loss. And people were sort of asking, how can you really extrapolate from age 5 to survival?
I think really what you can do at age 5 is you can extrapolate to things like stair climbing and loss of ambulation. I think the further and further you get out, the weaker those relationships become. But I think if we're doing ambulatory trials, I think that, one of the aspects that clinical endpoints obtained during an ambulatory phase actually predict is the loss of ambulation. And I think it's pretty clear from the data, you know, when regulatory authorities ask what's the meaningfulness of a 30-meter change on a 6-minute walk test, you know, it really isn't so much the fact that a patient can ambulate 30 meters in a 6-minute period of time longer. It's really a marker of disease progression. To confirm that, if the marker of disease progression actually predicts a clinically meaningful milestone, such as loss of ambulation, and loss of ambulation really does predict loss of hand to mouth and loss and onset of ventilation, then we can begin to actually connect the dots to really show the meaningfulness of changing disease progression in a younger population and how that can actually extrapolate to positive effects later on in the disease. If you remember, the steroid trials conducted early on really were conducted predominantly in an ambulatory population. And it's really with decades of experience with steroids and collection of data over time that we've really been able to collect data showing that steroids not only improve things like standing time or ambulation, but steroids also improve arm function, they prevent scoliosis, they improve pulmonary function. And I think with these drugs restoring dystrophin, you know, my guess is that patients treated for longer periods of time are going to demonstrate, you know, similar significant improvements in terms of their really clinically meaningful milestones such as arm function and pulmonary function and ventilatory function.
So, and just along those lines, two quick final questions about these predictions of loss. Because everyone has immediately applied this filter to their child as they were listening to you talk about these things. We've had one question about the definition of rising from the floor, is that with or without hands? And then someone else who has asked, have you seen any of these sorts of, or can you make predictions based on delayed milestone as opposed to loss of function? So, for example, a child who walks late, is that predictive or do we have that data?
Well, we don't really have the developmental data corresponding with these milestones. We know that very young infants and toddlers with Duchenne do have some changes in their developmental milestones and developmental testing, and we would hope that earlier treatment would have an impact on those milestones that ultimately would translate to improved function longer term. But, you know, in terms of some of these time function tests, I use them clinically, you know, really on a daily basis, in my clinic as I see patients. I assess their ability to get off the floor, and that's with use of hands is fine. It's generally not pushing off furniture, but pushing off the lower extremities is perfectly acceptable on that measure. In addition, we use the 10-meter walk run test, which is easily obtained in clinic as an indicator of disease progression and risk of losing milestones over the ensuing 1 to 2 years. So there are a variety of these measures that actually can be used in the clinic and not just in the context of a clinical trial.
Okay, so we're well past the hour here, so I think we're going to conclude. I'm sure there are questions maybe that some of you had or will think of later. You can send those questions to me at sharon@parentprojectmd.org, and we'll see if we can get answers to some of those if they weren't answered here. Also, this as you've seen, this is this webinar has been recorded, and it should be available in a couple of days if you know anyone who's missed it. And I think altogether we'd really like to thank Dr. McDonald for spending his time to go through this data so carefully. Thank you very much.
It's my pleasure. And I think there's really, I think, some very exciting therapeutics on the horizon. I think the critical issue at this point in time is really developing the clinical trials and designing the clinical trials so we can really make these cases with the FDA that these drugs are having a tremendous effect on these boys and young men with Duchenne dystrophy.
Okay, thank you. We appreciate it very much. All right, this concludes our presentation. Thank you. Bye-bye.